Well, welcome everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here with my friend and colleague, Raj Day. Raj is going to be our distinguished speaker for our second in our interdisciplinary distinguished addresses on cybersecurity. Raj is now a partner at Mayer Brown in the Washington, D.C. office. He leads the firm's global cybersecurity and data privacy practice, which we know today is an important thing. It's in a lot of discussions. Before joining Mayer Brown, he served as the general counsel to the United States National Security Agency. And in that capacity, he served as the agency's chief legal officer and senior advisor directly to the director of the National Security Agency. Prior to this, he served in the Department of Justice as Principal Deputy Assistant Attorney General for the Office of Legal Policy. He worked closely with the DOJ leadership and on a number of different legal activities. Earlier in his career, he served as a counsel to the Senate Homeland Security and Government Affairs Committee, including the National Commission on Terrorist Attacks Upon the United States. That's the 911 Commission. He also started his career as Attorney General in the Honors Program at the Department of Justice. He clerked for the Honorable Wallace Tashima of the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit. He also graduated magna cum laude for both Harvard Law School and Harvard College. So again, it's my great pleasure to introduce Raj to all of you, and let's have a hearty welcome for Raj.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. That sounds like an intro my parents might have written for Starin, so I appreciate that, those kind words. So I thought I'd start out with some remarks, but I really hope you all feel encouraged to ask questions either along the way, or maybe we'll reserve kind of the second half of the time for some questions. You have a former NSA guy here, and I'm sure you probably have lots of questions or comments or thoughts. NSA is one of those things that tends to inspire thoughts, to say the least. So maybe what I'll start with is a little bit about myself and about NSA. I thought I'd touch on the evolution of the cyber threat, just to give you some baseline context, and then talk about some of the legal and regulatory and policy issues that I'm seeing now in private practice and that are affecting businesses and people out in the world every day. Not necessarily the stuff that's happening in government, but the stuff that is really impacting our lives. So by way of background, as Starin's mentioned, and tell me if you can hear me all right as I walk around, it's a little bright under there. I was at NSA as a general counsel from 2012 to 2015. Now, if you're thinking of those years, that means about a year before Snowden and about a year up until the Sony hack. So it was a pretty busy time, to say the least. And it was so busy, in fact, that one of the running jokes in our family is about relating that time to my previous experience. I had served in the White House in a job called Staff Secretary for President Obama, which is the job of managing all the paper that goes to the president on a daily basis, everything from his PDB, which is the acronym for President's Daily Brief, the threat information he gets every night, to decision memos on Social Security policy, to memos on who should be picked for the next Supreme Court justice, for example, to use something timely. So it was a very, very stressful job, 24/7 sort of job. Traveled with the president all over the world on Air Force One, and basically didn't see my kids for those 2 years. Now, I'm one of the few people in Washington who can say that time in the White House was actually less stressful than my next job, serving as a GC at NSA. It was a busy, busy time post-Snowden. And partly that's because of the mission set, and partly that's because of all the things you've read about in the paper, and all the controversy, and all the questions you probably have about what NSA does and what it doesn't do. One thing folks don't realize, I think, is the mission set of NSA and why it's relevant to cyber, the topic for today. So for much of its history, NSA was very secret, and the acronym was thought to stand for No Such Agency, because basically it was an agency in the shadows. Now, I think the secret, the acronym these days might stand for no secrets anymore, or as my wife put it, after 6 years in government, no savings allowed, but pick your acronym. It could mean just about anything. But the point being, for many years, folks had no idea what NSA did. Now, chances are you probably have a pretty good sense today of some of NSA's mission, and that's mostly the spying stuff, the foreign intelligence mission. But what most people don't realize is in addition to that spying mission, that espionage mission, it also has a whole nother function called information assurance. And without getting into the weeds of what information assurance means, it's effectively a cyber defense mission for what are called national security systems. And that's the formal legal term for the types of communication systems used in the federal government by and large to transmit classified information. So think about the classified email systems between the Pentagon and the CIA, for example, or think about the communication systems that are needed to send real-time threat intelligence information to our men and women in the field in some very dangerous places. Think of a commander on the ground in a place like Afghanistan who's directing a convoy and needs to understand what the latest threat chatter is about where IEDs may be located. That information has to get to that person in the field in a secure way. And part of NSA's mission is building and setting the standards for that sort of secure communication. So that's what's wrapped up in this information assurance mission. So one aspect of NSA's mission is very relevant to cybersecurity and what we think about in the private sector. How do we make sure that our financial transactions are secure? How do we make sure that our personal information, healthcare information, or otherwise is secure in its systems? A lot of the same thinking, a lot of the same technology, a lot of the same framework is built into our private sector cybersecurity. Now, the second way in which NSA is relevant for cybersecurity is with respect to the sort of breaches that we've all read about in the papers for the past several years. Every time you open the paper and you read about a major company that's been hacked, you probably see a line that says the FBI is investigating or the Department of Homeland Security is working with the entity if it's part of critical infrastructure. But what you don't read about is that if it's significant enough, and if it may involve a foreign adversary, a foreign nation state, chances are the NSA is involved, or at least NSA personnel are involved. And that's through a process called technical support for other agencies. So in other words, if the FBI is investigating something, they need the best and the brightest brains in the US government to assist. A lot of that expertise, for historical and other reasons, is at the NSA. And so a lot of the sort of cybersecurity issues we see on the front pages of the papers actually have some of NSA expertise helping to solve the problem. And so if I were to sum up the role of NSA in that regard, it is visibility into the foreign cyber threats that we experience and some of the greatest technical and cryptologic, which means code breaking and code making expertise in the US government resides in this agency. Okay, so what does that all mean? Well, over those 3 years that I spent at NSA, it meant that I and my office, which is about 100 lawyers or so, and the leadership of the agency had a pretty good visibility into the evolution of the cyber threat over the past decade, 15, 20 years. And what was amazing to me is even in the last 3, 4, 5 years, we could see a rapid, dynamic evolution in that threat. So let me give you a broad brush picture for those of you who may be less familiar with cybersecurity. If you ask somebody 10 or 15 years ago, what is the biggest cyber threats that we're seeing, or the most common, the most prevalent, most people would say the biggest threat is about the stealing of stuff, whatever that stuff is. It could be personal information. The legal term would be personally identifiable information, PII. Or it could be about the stealing of intellectual property. Think of the plans for the next jet fighter or the plans for the next significant commercial development in a given industry. The stealing of stuff. And the term we use for that is exploitation. So the first level of the cyber threat was exploitation. And over the years, as you'll see, this threat grows more and more multi-layered. Now, about the time I got to NSA in 2012 or so, we started to see a second layer of the cyber threat emerge into public consciousness. The first layer, as I said, was exploitation. The second layer, for lack of a better term, we would call disruption. And what do I mean by that? I mean the sorts of attacks, for example, that we saw on many Wall Street banks in 2011, 2012, 2013. They were DDoS attacks, and for those not that familiar, that basically means, it stands for distributed denial of service attacks, but basically a whole lot of web traffic being directed to a particular site. And the consequence was the public-facing websites of several significant Wall Street institutions being brought down for anywhere from just a few seconds to a few days. There was a little bit of a spectrum. No long-term damage, but rattling nonetheless for an industry significantly dependent on the security of its communications network. So phase one, exploitation. Now suddenly you have this more complex threat evolving through disruption. Around 2013, 2014, we started to see, at least publicly, another layer, another level of the threat start to break through the fore, and that was destruction. So first we had exploitation, disruption, and now we're starting to see destructive attacks. And the best known publicly acknowledged examples of destruction would be things like the attack on something called the Saudi Aramco Oil Company, in which overnight there were some 30,000 computers that were just bricked, basically made unusable, hunks of metal, no data access, no longer functional, just like that, gone, 30,000 computers. There's been some public speculation and about the actors involved, largely focusing on Iranian tied actors. So that was one example of destruction. Another example might be the attack on the Las Vegas Sands Casino, which also had a similar but a little bit smaller scale event. And then finally, the most commonly thought of example is probably the hack on Sony, which was in the winter of 2014, I guess now. And the US government has now attributed this to North Korean actors. But in addition to all the stuff you may have read about in the papers, the salacious emails about movie stars, the employee information, the stealing of some of the movies under development, all that stuff we kind of read about, there was also a significant part of this attack that disabled thousands of computers and forced them to be pulled offline. And that is a very worrying development in the progression of the threat. So we had exploitation, we have disruption, we have destruction. And now, if you start listening to what senior intelligence officials are talking about publicly, you just have to look to public testimony of the Director of National Intelligence, a man named Jim Clapper, or the current CIA Director, John Brennan, or my old boss and client, Admiral Rogers at the NSA, you start to hear a lot of murmuring and explicit testimony about the threat of manipulation. So you had exploitation, disruption, destruction, and now manipulation. And so what do we mean by manipulation? Well, it can have a few different strands. One strand has to do with the manipulation of data. So the only thing worse than taking your data or making it inaccessible or even destroying it is fiddling with it, basically, in a way that undermines the integrity of the entire data set or the integrity of the entire system that processes that data. Think in the most stereotypical example of messing around with bank accounts. And if one can't trust electronic records, one can't trust the entire system built on those electronic records. So that's one strand of manipulation. Another would be the manipulation of physical objects in the increasingly connected Internet of Things. So I have clients that have today lots of products that in the old days were really nothing more than hunks of steel with other physical parts, but now are effectively computers surrounded by steel. Think of a modern car, a modern smart car, which today has more processing power, of course, than many of our early computers, and for all intents and purposes, is really a computer on wheels, connected to the internet. So this fear of manipulation is clearly what's animating a lot of concern, because you have both potential for broader scale impact in confidence of systems and the potential for physical harm as a result of cyber intrusions. So we've seen this overarching evolution of the cyber threat over the past 10 to 15 years in this broad brush way. But beneath that, there's several other things that are happening. If you spoke to an intelligence analyst 3 or 4 or 5 years ago about who are our cyber adversaries, chances are they would have broken it into a few buckets. You have nation states, so the ones people tend to acknowledge publicly are North Korea, Iran, China, and Russia are kind of the big players in this space. They would have said, okay, you have those nation states, but you also have criminal groups, those who are just looking to steal data, credit card information, turn it around for a quick buck. It's just, cyber is just a tool in their arsenal. And then you have hacktivists, those who perform certain destructive or other activities for a political purpose or some other reason. And the actors kind of aligned neatly into those buckets. But what we're seeing today is that those buckets no longer neatly define the world. We're starting to see a lot of crossover between state actors and what were traditionally private actors. So think of a hostile foreign government funding a nascent criminal enterprise. Think of a politically motivated hacktivist who needs funding to carry out what they're going to do, so they hook up with a criminal enterprise. These neatly bucketed areas are starting to bleed into one another, and that has consequences for how you treat the threat overall. So the actors are morphing. In addition to the actors morphing, we have the tactics morphing. So 20 years ago, 15 years ago, cyber defense was all about the detection of malware. Basically, can you find the bad code that people are trying to put in your computers? And the term for that is called signature detection. Can you detect a bad piece of code? Now, the folks doing this, nation states and others, are pretty sophisticated and have realized that it's not all dependent on code. The biggest weakness in cybersecurity is people, human behavior. Think of somebody in your office clicking on a link that they've been told 20 times not to click on. Think of your own passwords. You know, how many passwords do you have that, if not 12345, nevertheless aren't the most sophisticated passwords? And how many different types of accounts do you use that same password or same combination of words for? The human element is clearly something cyber adversaries are preying on and moving into. And then finally, I would say, in addition to an evolution of the actors and the tactics, we're seeing an evolution in the type of information folks may be going after. It's no longer just credit card information or social security numbers. As we become more digital, more and more valuable information is made available to cyber adversaries. And it may not be for a quick buck. It may be for a long-term plan to build profiles of the US population, if I were to take a national view about this, or of anybody. Think of, for example, the breach on the Office of Personnel Management last year. And while the government hasn't acknowledged the actors involved, there's a lot of speculation that it may be Chinese actors. We haven't seen, at least publicly, any acknowledgement that that information has shown up on the black market, which suggests to one that maybe commercial gain isn't the point of that kind of breach. It makes one wonder, well, what is? What could be the long-term plan for that sort of information? So as we think about the cyber threat, we need to think about the reasons adversaries may be looking for information or conducting some of the other activities that I mentioned. So where does this take us? If we have this evolution of the threat and all these moving pieces in terms of who's doing it, why they're doing it, what they're going after, what has been the result? Well, the result is a far more complex landscape, one that's evolving quickly, one that's impacting all of us, businesses and individuals alike, and one that requires the creation of incentives so that we take the appropriate collective action as a society, as a country, as a networked country. Which leads me to some trends that we're seeing in the space that I deal in, the legal, policy, regulatory space. Like, what's happening there? You probably read every day about cyber this or cyber that. So I thought I'd mention at least one trend in each of those areas: litigation, regulatory, and policy. And that'll give you some sense of how much movement is actually happening. And for someone like me, a lawyer in private practice, what are my clients thinking about? Everything from multinational corporations to a mom and pop shop that has 5 employees but stores their personal information. So a few things. Okay, let me start with litigation. So of all the breaches you read about, whether it's a breach on Target, Home Depot, Neiman Marcus, whatever, whenever something bad happens to someone, our society is set up to have one immediate reaction by a subset of the population: sue. right? Lawsuits, we have a very vibrant legal system. Now, for several years, most of the types of lawsuits brought against cyber breach victims, most, not all, by consumers or employees, have been kicked out of court on the basis of something called standing. Now, for the non-lawyers in the room, standing is the word for having the right to bring a lawsuit, basically. And it derives from the Constitution. And the basic idea is you have to have an actual case or controversy for a court to hear it. Courts are not the place to air a general grievance. They're not a place to hash out a policy issue. Judges are there to decide particular cases. So out of that general notion has evolved this concept of standing. And the reason most plaintiffs have gotten kicked out of court on the grounds of standing is that even if there is a breach, and even if certain data has been taken, most plaintiffs generally can't allege that something bad happened to them as a result of that breach. There's no actual injury in fact. And if you delve into the legal doctrine, there's actually several parts of standing. There's something called injury in fact. You have to show a concrete injury, something happened. You have to allege that it was caused by the bad conduct of the defendant. And you have to allege that the relief you're asking for from the court would actually fix that harm. Those are kind of the elements of standing. And so generally, when 30,000 credit cards or payment information is stolen or something else happens, it's pretty hard for a class action plaintiff, because generally these cases are brought on behalf of all 30,000 cardholders or all 500,000 cardholders, can't show or can't even allege that something bad happened to them as a result of that breach. They may fear it, we may all fear it, but they can't show it, especially when a company pays for credit monitoring and some of the precautionary things that have to happen. Now, what we've seen over the past few years is judges pushing the limits of that legal doctrine. And some cases have been moving forward. So an example is the case that's grown out of a breach on Neiman Marcus, a store that folks shop in, a retail clothing store. And what the court found in that case, and this is out of the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, so one of the federal appellate courts just below the Supreme Court, was that the increased risk of fraud for somebody who is information was taken as part of a breach could be a sufficiently concrete injury for those plaintiffs to bring a lawsuit. Now, if that sort of logic holds, and if that reasoning continues, we could see a sweeping sea change in the way lawsuits are conducted after cyber breaches. No longer will it be sufficient for a defendant to say, you can't show that anything bad happened to you. It's this increased fear. Now, another strand of that is, does there actually have to be real harm? And that issue is pending before the Supreme Court right now in a case called Spokio v. Robbins. Now, this case is not about a cyber breach, but the fundamental issue is whether an injury in law, which is the fancy term for basically a violation of a statute, is sufficient injury for plaintiffs to bring suit when there's no actual injury in fact, no real world injury. And the facts of this case are kind of interesting. It's a lawsuit brought against Spokio, which as you all probably know is an aggregator online that collects publicly available information so you can get a profile of somebody. And full disclosure, my law firm argued this case in the Supreme Court, not me personally. But the person who brought this lawsuit is alleging that there was a violation of a particular federal statute, which is irrelevant here. But in fact, is saying the information that Spokio put out there publicly about me was incorrect, but honestly, it kind of made him look better. It suggested he had more education than he did, suggested he had a wife and three kids, which he did not, suggested he had a much more elaborate work history, which he did not. So the issue is not harm. Nothing bad happened to the plaintiff here. The issue is, by virtue of there being an actual violation of a statute that didn't result in any harm, can someone bring a lawsuit? And so if the Supreme Court rules that an injury in law is sufficient, we might see a whole lot of data breach lawsuits have regained life, because often there is a state statute that may be at issue and there may be no actual harm, but a data breach victim, a company that is a victim, may actually be in violation of a state statute. So litigation, there is a huge swell of developments in that space. Okay, regulation. There are a host of federal and state, but mostly federal regulatory agencies interested in cybersecurity. the FTC, which is the Federal Trade Commission, the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, and most recently in the last week, the CFPB, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. But you can pick your industry. NHTSA, which is the National Highway Transportation Association, is starting to look at cyber vulnerabilities in cars. The FDA is starting to look at exploring medical device cybersecurity. Think of insulin pumps, pacemakers that are all connected to digitally to sensors and the internet. And so one big overarching trend is, are these various regulatory agencies going to take disparate sector-specific approaches to cybersecurity? And the problem of that would be multifold, but think of a company, any of my clients, that is regulated by more than one entity. If you have the CFPB articulating certain types of standards, and you have the SEC articulating a different type of disclosure standard, and you have the Federal Trade Commission articulating different standards, what is a company supposed to do? It will become increasingly complex and increasingly expensive to comply with multiple regulatory regimes. And this overarching trend, I think, is something to watch over the next year or two, because it's hard to overstate the impact of a regulatory regime on a business. And one sector that is extremely familiar with this is the financial services sector. They are regulated by federal and state entities and are probably the most advanced when it comes to cybersecurity. But think of a car company being regulated by NHTSA and the FTC, and if they handle, for example, consumer loans by the CFPB, you could have multiple agencies regulating their cyber policies. The last area I wanted to focus on was policy. What's happening in the policy space? Well, one major development in the last several months has been the passage of a law called the Cybersecurity Information Sharing Act. CISA is the acronym. It was passed in December, signed by the president, and it's been a piece of legislation that's been in the works for years. It was in the works before I got to NSA in 2012, and it finally passed this last year. And without getting into the details of the law, although I'm happy to if anyone wants to, the big picture is it's intended to create incentives for private businesses to share cyber threat information with the government, for the government to share cyber threat information with private businesses, and for businesses to collaborate on protecting themselves as an industry. Until this point, if you were a private business and you had a cyber incident, you might have something called cyber threat indicators, the technical information that could be relevant to understanding what happened or who the adversary was. You might be reluctant to have shared that information with the federal government or with your fellow companies so that they could protect themselves because you might have faced legal liability. There's a whole range of statutes that could have gotten in the way. What this new law did was basically clear the field and say, if you're a cyber victim and you're sharing certain types of information for a certain good purpose, protecting ourselves, you can do that without fear of legal liability. And so this bill is really, I think, going to shape the next generation of cybersecurity, because it will, at a minimum, allow for us to have greater visibility into what's happening. Places like the NSA have a pretty good sense of what's happening outside the US on networks in foreign countries and with foreign adversaries. But we don't have a comprehensive visibility into what's happening in the US for good reason. We don't want the NSA crawling over all of our computer systems in the US. And if you're an individual business, you have pretty good visibility into your own networks, but you don't have visibility into your supplier's network, for example, or another industry's networks. And so the first step in tackling any threat is having a sense of the threat landscape overall. And that's what this bill is intended to do. Okay, let me close with one last point, and then I would love to take questions and comments, anything. So what do all these changes mean, particularly for, at least in my current role, private businesses? It means that most boards of directors of public companies are finally awake to the threat of cybersecurity. You know, all it takes is the firing of one CEO or some shareholder activist to call for the resignation of a board of a company that's been breached for directors to wake up. So most directors are pretty cognizant of what's going on. The issue is what to do about it. We have limited resources. Any business has limited resources. What are you supposed to do? And so much of my time now is spent advising boards on folding cyber risk into their overall risk management exercises. So think of cyber risk as another component of all the risks a business must deal with. And one of the most important tools, I think, that will drive where we go as a private economy is going to be the insurance market. Now, the insurance market is filled with folks who, for a living, figure out likelihood and consequence of risk and price it. Basically, that's what insurance is. And the insurance market for cyber has been woefully immature because of the lack of information for a lot of the reasons I've been talking about. But now that we have some of the tools in place to share more information, and the Department of Homeland Security is trying to push the development of this industry, I think we're going to start to see a blossoming of the cyber insurance industry, and that may help set the incentives in a way that promotes the right kind of collective action. So anyway, that's a little bit of a treetop's view of my world, both from the NSA and now back in private practice, but I would love to take questions or comments about anything. So please, if you have a thought, don't be shy. Over the last few years, I can guarantee you I've been asked just about anything, so I will not take offense.
I have two questions, Raj. First, there's been a lot of discussion about moving to more of a cloud environment and, you know, what are the advantages and disadvantages. And then touching on your last sector, financial sector, or any of the critical infrastructure sectors, if you were the general counsel for a board of directors, and you're trying to quantify this to set with, in terms of rider, or I'll call it business interruption insurance or continuity of operation, how does one go about that when there's not a lot of data yet to quantify risk, reward type of thing to set the terms of those riders?
So the first question is about the cloud environment and what are the positives and negatives of that from a, I suppose, from a policy perspective, just generally. I think the positives are twofold. Efficiency, of course. That's the whole point, is we don't need to all have huge servers in our basements, unless you're running for president. But you can more efficiently share these services. And expertise. Presumably, if you're a cloud provider, you have some expertise in data management, and you can provide your expertise in that regard. I think the biggest disadvantage is dependency, increased dependency on a third party that is outside your control, for all intents and purposes. And much of my legal practice these days is not that sexy or exciting, is about evaluating contracting provisions for things like cloud services. How is risk allocated? For what sorts of events is the cloud service provider liable? What sort of events is the customer responsible for? So I think it's inevitable that we're going to head more in the direction of course, cloud computing, but there are some real positives and negatives that businesses need to think through. And on the second point about insurance, consideration of insurance, you know, without being an insurance expert myself, I would say that most policies these days are limited in a few ways. Either there is a extremely low cap, so if you have a catastrophic cyber event, you are going to be out of luck past like $100 million, which doesn't get you that far beyond the fees of someone like myself at the end of the day, but the actual business interruption costs. So there's limits. There's also a lot of significant carve-outs, and so because there's a lack of information about cyber threats, and frankly, insurers are struggling to get information about the security of their insureds, they need to protect themselves so that they're not out of business. And many policies these days have significant carve-outs for the types of events that won't be covered. And I think an unsophisticated buyer in this space is likely to run into one of those traps. But those are some of the big holes today. Other questions about, yes?
Prior to the financial cycle last year, I was an IT security consultant for about 8 years for various government agencies. And apart from the NSA having the mission of protecting military and intelligence organizations, I noted that in the executive branch agencies, it's incredibly slipshod as to how well they implement IT security. Some agencies do a very good job. Some agencies just push as much paper around as they can to make it look like they're doing a good job.
Definitely.
Having been one of the people, millions of people who have had their SF-86 stolen by China, Why isn't there an agency whose job it is to provide IT security infrastructure to all agencies so that they're standardized and effective broadly across the spectrum, instead of having some agencies that are great and some agencies that are terrible?
Yeah, and so that's a very good question. And for those who didn't hear, it's about the variability in basically the level of competence across the federal government for managing cyber risk. So I think part of the answer is it's clearer than one might think. It just may not be that good. And part of the answer is even the places that are the best are still woefully inadequate. And so what do I mean by that? On the first point, NSA is basically responsible for what are called .IC or .MIL accounts. Those are the domains that I was referring to earlier for military or intelligence communications. DHS, on paper, is responsible for the .gov world, which we, most of us would think of as the government network, any old government agency and their email accounts and so forth. And I think one thing we saw with the OPM breach that you were referring to, and I got my letter too for my information being stolen, is a couple things. One, the Department of Homeland Security has struggled with getting the sufficient authority to do what it's tasked with doing. And I think the president and the executive branch have been trying to push in that regard to give them the tools they need to insist that a place like OPM, for example, is up to snuff, which is a challenge. And two, a problem that isn't that dissimilar from the private sector. You know, one of the first conversations I have with almost any client is talking with them about why they might be a cyber victim. For somebody who doesn't live and breathe this, you might think, well, if I don't have credit card information, or I don't have healthcare or social security information, why would anyone come after me? And for anybody in this space, you know that there's a whole host of reasons. It could be something as simple as you're the stepping stone to some other entity to whom you're connected. There's a whole reason, a host of reasons one could be a target. And I think there was a little of that going on in the OPM breach, for example. My sense is that folks at the Office of Personnel Management, for those of you who don't know, is kind of a standard government agency that does a whole lot of I hate to say back room stuff for the federal government, but the kind of stuff that any major organization needs, didn't think of itself as a potential target, and certainly didn't think of itself as part of the national security community, which very much thinks of itself as a potential target, despite the fact that they were holding such sensitive information of people like you and like me. And I think having the rest of the federal government appreciate why they might be a target is going to be half of the cultural battle, because part of it's a cultural thing. Yes?
I'd like to ask you about the Apple iPhone case.
Sure.
Could you summarize the legal arguments from both sides and then maybe speculate on the consequences if the government prevails, as well as the consequences if Apple prevails?
Certainly. Firstly, I'm very impressed that it took only until the second question. It wasn't the first question. So I'm happy to talk about the case. I have a few limits in total disclosure. My law firm represents some entities supporting Apple, and I represent some clients in this space as well. All that being said, the case is fundamentally about this, and I will phrase it in a way that probably betrays my particular bias in this particular case. It is about whether the government, with a valid legal warrant, can require a company to disable a booby trap on a phone they developed in a situation in which they have put themselves in the driver's seat as the only people possible to develop that disabling feature for the phone. And I say it that way because I think this case is distinct from bigger issues, policy issues. But let me talk about the case in particular. So what's going on is this is an older version iPhone. I mean, everyone here must have heard of this case if you've been awake in the last few weeks. But it has to do with one of the iPhones that one of the San Bernardino shooters had that was recovered by law enforcement. And what's going on is the four-digit code on the phone, you know, the password we all have, if you try more than 10 times and get 10 incorrect answers, it will wipe the phone. So in other words, you get 10 tries and you're out. So the government actually had the phone and has a warrant to look at the phone, but couldn't risk trying those passwords lest the entire piece of evidence be destroyed. And so under their under something called the All Writs Act, which is a very, very old statute that's written at a very general level to help the government achieve affect legal process, basically. So the government is saying, no, no, we are allowed to require you, Apple, to disable this feature because we have the overriding legal authority to get into the phone. And I would analogize it in the physical world to imagine a company that's a safe builder, and on the safes that they build, they put a little bomb on the top that if attempted to be unlocked by an unauthorized user, will self-destruct the device. And the government is saying, company, we're not asking you to drill a hole in your safe. We're not asking you to give us the password of the safe. We're asking you to disable that feature that you've put on there. That's the extent of what's happening in this case. Now, I say it that way, and you know, I'm a lawyer, so the idea is to get you to think, oh, that's so obvious. Of course the company should do that. But to your question, the consequences are what's really at stake. And I think from a critic's point of view, I think the strongest argument against the government here, from a policy perspective, not necessarily legal, but you can translate into legalese, is the government hasn't done a good job of articulating what is the limit of that theory. If you can force Apple to write some software code to disable this booby trap feature that I described, what else can you do, government? What else can you require any business to do in any situation where you have legal authority? And we should all be a little scared and a little skeptical of where that authority would end. And I think those are, if I were to pare it all down and strip away the legalese around it, I think is fundamentally what it's coming to. And that's why when you read about this case, the word everyone uses is precedent. Where is this taking us? Because I think most reasonable-minded people would probably think if there was a way to do it without any further consequence, of course we should have a known terrorist, known dead terrorist phone be available to law enforcement. Most reasonable people get to that place. But what does that imply, I think, is the real fundamental policy question, and where does it go? I would say, if I could just close on this, I would say this issue about this phone in this court case, in my mind, is distinct from the bigger, far more complex issue of when and under what circumstances can the government require features built into encryption systems to allow for government access. And that's the kind of bigger encryption debate. That is a, which has to do with product design on the front end, not just trying to disable like a booby trap on the back end. Yes? The legal issue doesn't really come down to the resource one for a couple of reasons. One, certainly. The question was, is this really coming down to a resource question, I think, if I'm characterizing it right, is the government's forcing a private business to do something that it has to spend money on and becoming an agent of the government, kind of, so to speak. So this sort of assistance in other contexts is not that unusual. When the government effectuates a wiretap, for example, it needs the assistance of the phone company, and they have to expend resources to assist, for example. And moreover, the government will often pay, and I don't know the details in this case, but I'm pretty sure the government will offer to pay for the exercise to happen. So it's not, in this case anyway, fundamentally about money, to my mind, and I bet if you asked Apple, they would agree. I think, from Apple's perspective, it's about forcing a company to take an affirmative action that undermines its very business model. In other words, I think if I were to put my voice in place of the opposition to the government, you are forcing me to break into a product that I built to be secure. And to do that, I have to create some software that I wouldn't otherwise create, and then therefore is going to weaken the entire product family. I think that is probably the strongest practical argument coming from Apple. Yeah, I'll come back to you. Yes, sir.
Technology moves so fast, yet the legislative process is so deliberate, slow. I have a fear that we're constantly going to be faced with this dilemma of established law versus problems that arise and require. Am I right in being concerned?
The question is, the laws, it moves so slowly, but technology and our problems are moving so fast, so should we be concerned about that misalignment? The answer is definitely yes. Yes, I think, you know, as part of what's underlying the Apple case, the All Writs Act is a static law built, written in a different era for different purposes, and this is completely outside the purview of what anyone would have conceived of when it was developed, of course. This, I mean, it was developed in the late 1700s. But we see this issue come about in lots of different contexts. Take one of the most controversial issues that came out of the Snowden disclosures, which was a program about telephone metadata. For those of you who aren't that familiar, this was about the bulk collection of telephone metadata, so not content, but information about calls to and from phone number and duration, anonymized, but from Americans as well as non-Americans in bulk. And it was conducted under a statute that goes by the shorthand of Section 215 of the Patriot Act, which was written for probably for other purposes. And so what happened in that case, apart from the merits, policy merits of what you think about collection, was you had a law being used for a purpose that I think was so distant from what the average person on the street would conceive of that law being used for, that it leads to this misalignment between law and policy and expectations. And that is a very dangerous place to be, because it, in a democracy, it means, do we have sufficient public consent for how the laws are being used, particularly in secret, for secret sorts of programs? But that's just one instantiation of the problem you raise. Technology and our problems are moving so fast, and unfortunately, our political system is, no matter where you sit on the spectrum, I think most people would agree is pretty broken in terms of the Congress working, and that's one consequence. Yes, ma'am.
And so a couple of things. I am concerned about the fact, and I would say when I run an healthcare organization and I have data that gets stolen, which seems to be a common day occurrence, we're talking now about the downstream use of it, so we're not maybe not seeing the problem now. How do I plan for my organization years from now when suddenly the data that's been stolen suddenly rears its ugly head? Another issue is that if I'm managing bring your own device technology program for my employees, how can I, it sounds like a perfect storm to me.
It is. So the question was, the questioner is in the healthcare industry, and how do you protect yourself with such sensitive information going forward, basically, particularly with things like, you know, bring your own iPhone to work sort of stuff. Well, I think one way to think about the problem set is not so much how do I prevent something from happening, although that's an important piece of things, but clearly the trend in the industry, and I think the thinking in policy circles, is moving just as much to detection and mitigation of cyber threats as to prevention, with the recognition that it's impossible to have 100% success rate on prevention. And I think one major area of focus of a lot of technology development now is reducing the average time to detection of a breach. You know, there's a number of reports that are out there by different vendors that quantify the average time it takes for a business to detect a breach. And, you know, depending on the survey, it's a little different here or there, but roughly it's about 200 days from start of a breach to detection of the breach on average. Now think about that, 200 days. For a sophisticated adversary, they need an afternoon at most. And so 200 days is clearly, if we get to a point of more automated information sharing, automated detection of threats, if we can bring that window down to 2 days, 1 day, hours, we could actually save ourselves a lot of heartache in addition to improving on the prevention side. And on that last part of your question about employees bringing their phones and so forth, of course, there's lots of technology that we can try to mitigate that threat, but I think that's a great example of what brings to the fore this issue of the human aspect of cybersecurity. Much of what we do and much of how we're going to succeed is about training our employees or our students or our customers, whatever the case may be, on some very, very basic steps. And it's shocking how much of the biggest devastation is wreaked by a failure to do basic blocking and tackling stuff. Passwords. I'm guilty of it too. I came from the NSA. My practice is cybersecurity. Am I the perfect model? Probably not. And it's just hard to do. It's a very human thing for all of us, and I think that's going to be a key piece. Yes, sir.
Can you comment on the Clinton email server and that controversy?
Other than a joke, probably not. I'm affiliated with the Clinton campaign, and I would just say this. I think if my director at NSA had made that proposal and I was a general counsel, I think my advice would have been clear, irrespective of what the law allows. It just seems like something that's going to invite criticism, just to say the least. Yes?
I don't really think the government should have in maintaining the integrity of the infrastructure of the internet. You mentioned the threat of disruption and destruction. It's clearly somewhat fragile. Is the government working on that at all?
So the question is the responsibility of the government in maintaining the sort of integrity of the internet at a general level. You know, one of the beautiful things about our infrastructure is by and large it's privately owned. Now that comes with a downside. It's less organized than one might want. It's perhaps less protected than if it were a military installation. The positive is it flourishes as technology and innovation moves. It's not strapped down by sort of the worst parts of government. And from a personal freedom standpoint, that's the basis of our economy. And I think a lot of folks would have concern about a significant role for the US government all over domestic networks. So then the question becomes, under what circumstances does the US government get involved? And I think you see it on multiple levels. The big picture strategy is one of incentivizing the private sector to take the right steps, and that's a lot of what the Department of Homeland Security does, and that's what this sort of legislation is intended to encourage and so forth. And then the really hard question is, at what point does a cyber threat or a cyber attack become a national security defense department issue? I think that is a very hard question, one we struggle with all the time. But when does it become the analog of a missile coming into the US to destroy a US neighborhood? And it's very complicated for a variety of reasons in cyberspace because of lack of physical boundaries, different thresholds for harm and consequence, doctrines like proportionality, which means you can only take action proportional to the attack. So the sort of the doctrine of preemption. There's a whole range of legal theories around the law of war that I think haven't totally been hashed out around cyber war. And I wish I had a better answer, but I think that is kind of the big open question. Yes? Sure. By incentivizing, I mean setting up incentives or setting up legal regimes that that reward private entities for taking the sort of action we would hope they would take from a policy perspective, whether that's being parts of a good cyber ecosystem and sharing information with partners, for example, whether it means forcing entities to take a hard evaluation at their insurance options, or at least encouraging them to do so. And for example, the Department of Homeland Security has a program in which they're trying to build an aggregated database of cyber threat information to help insurance companies have sufficient data set to underwrite better. And so the idea of voluntary incentives is really intended to set up the conditions so that the private sector on its own moves in the policy direction we would like to take without prescriptive mandates. It could be, but it doesn't have to be, exactly. There's lots of incentives, finances, liability protection, whole range of things. Sure, yes?
There's the saying,
so the question is about cyber offense and kind of how does that fit into the big picture. So the other term in the private sector folks may hear about is hacking back, under what, when can that happen and is it legal? And in the government context, it probably has to do with offensive cyber operations. So I'd say a few things. In the government context, what we as lay people would think of as offensive cyber operations can happen in all sorts of different ways. Sometimes something that is actually intelligence collection may be perceived as an offensive cyber act. Sometimes offensive cyber action could be taken as part of a military action, in which case there's a whole law of war and military doctrine that applies. Cyber action, conceivably, like any other sort of activity, could be part of covert action, which is something the US government does but doesn't acknowledge. In the private sector, I think the real issue is something called the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, which is a statute that basically, it's complex and I won't get into it here, but basically says you can't do damage on other people's networks. I mean, don't take that as legal advice, but that's really the gist of the law. And so there's a lot of active discussion about if we can't defend ourselves 100% and we need a greater deterrence effect, what sort of offensive action should we allow and how should we change the law to effectuate that? And you can think of a whole range of things on that spectrum. You know, of course, at one end is kind of what we would all think of as real offensive stuff, doing something really bad to the person who steals your data, blowing up their networks. You know, that seems probably outside the bounds of what most reasonable people think a private company should be doing. Think of, for example, what happened if Sony had done that before we knew it was North Korea? And that would, of course, have global consequences. But things as simple as setting up traps for understanding what somebody is doing on your network, or at least going out to pull back data that might have been pulled from your networks, even some of those activities are perceived as offensive under the CFAA. And I think along that whole spectrum, there's probably some room for growth about what we think people should be able to do to defend themselves, rather than sit back and wait to get punched and then cry about it, basically.
Okay. Does someone want to go first?
I think I have one more in the back, and then.
So I'm wondering if I can abstract a question that you didn't really answer.
Sure.
In a way that you can. So the first part is, in your estimation, what's the probability that the active state actors know the email addresses of top government officials? And then secondly, can you comment on the robustness of an official government secure network versus a private sector system?
So the first question, what's the likelihood that hostile foreign governments have the emails of senior government officials? 100%. 100%, I think, is the answer to that one. And then, of course, it gets more complicated when you talk about at what level and of government and what sort of access and so forth. And on the second question, the sophistication question, it really depends in the sense that the private sector is such a varied thing, it's hard to talk about it as a monolith. So you have, at one end, financial services entities that are pretty darn sophisticated, or at least getting there, in terms of their approach to cybersecurity. And then you have mom and pop shops who are barely staying afloat, and the last thing they can think about is securing their networks, to the extent they even think about their networks. And in the government, per the question earlier, there's also a pretty wide range. On the one end, you have a place like NSA. On the other hand, you have a place like OPM. Now, even with that said, keep in mind, NSA is the place that Snowden happened. And this, for all intents and purposes, that is a data breach. That is an insider threat data breach. And post WikiLeaks, there was and this was the stealing of lots of information by Bradley Manning, you may recall. There was an entire government-wide process to improve the network security of a whole range of networks. NSA was actually at the cutting edge of effectuating those changes. And Snowden still happened at a place like NSA. So I think, unfortunately, even though I would say that it's one of the most sophisticated entities out there, even they can get hit.
Okay. I had a couple questions regarding national security. And this first question, I don't want it to cause an emotional moment, but looking past at your experience at the White House and the time it took away from your family, and then moving into a more aggressive situation that took even more time away, this question has to do with capacity and capability. And you have already alluded to the fact that the adversary has significant capability, and we all know that. So how is it, I want you to comment on strategies that might have been discussed at the White House or NSA. How do we get an equal amount of capability within this nation to protect the Republic given the fact that people such as yourself have to give so much, and the monetary gain isn't there if you're out in the private sector, you know, to keep up with the capacity and the capability that seems to be fomenting as a tidal wave on the other side of the fence? And then I have a follow-up question.
Sure. Well, I think, you know, cyber in some ways is the perfect asymmetric threat, in the sense that you can have a kid in a basement somewhere with like zero resources require a whole lot of resources defensively from the US. And on the flip side, if you are a US business, you could have the resources of an entire nation state lined up to get your info. And of course, if no matter what you are, financial institution or otherwise, it's pretty hard to combat that threat. So what does one do? So some of the capacity building has to be resources, but it's not just enough to grow stronger. I think we have to grow smarter as well. But on the first point about resources, one thing we thought a lot about in the White House and at NSA in particular was increasing the flexibility of employment in the federal government and increasing the incentives for folks to move from the private sector to the government and back and forth. Traditionally, a place like NSA is a place where people may have gone when they were 24 and stayed until they retired. It's a culture that inspires loyalty. People feel very patriotic and get a lot of job satisfaction. And so they stay there for their careers. But that's not how the world works anymore. I mean, young people today, you know, they change jobs after 6 months or a year, particularly in the Valley. You know, it's a very fluid environment. And so having the government think more creatively about allowing some of that fluidity, I think, is something that folks are giving and have given a lot of thought to in their particular job training programs, exchanges, and other sorts of programs that are intended to accomplish that.
Using that as a bridge to the next question, and at the end of answering this question, if you could comment on whether you look at the horizon as in a view of optimism or pessimism. So again, segueing from capacity to capability, if we talk about that from a strategic perspective and then we are in a boardroom or at the White House situation we're talking about, I go, well, we have to have a fallback plan, because what if these ideas don't generate the capacity and capability we need? And you mentioned the insurance industry. So the car was invented just over 100 years ago, and we have a very sophisticated insurance industry surrounding our automobile use. But I don't feel safer, right? 55,000 people die every year in America on the highway, and yet we have this robust insurance. And if I heard you correctly, and I understand the concept, but to me, it's private sector profiting on recognition of cyber insecurity, not using the insurance industry as a way to get us to cybersecurity. I'm having difficulty seeing that connection, and I see more of industry profiting from the cyber insecurity. And so when you're in the White House, the question is for you to comment on, were there discussions, or do you have a sense of some more alternative radical idea that maybe the government should be legislating or incentivizing to get to me, it's a mismanagement of resources. So maybe these things could work on a very small scale, because again, using the automobile model, I don't see the roads being safer. Perhaps something radical has been discussed that we could use that same energy, money, and the one idea that I know has been bounced around, and maybe you can comment on other ideas, it's just tearing down this incredibly insecure system and rebuilding something that is secure. So, and then the optimism, pessimism.
So I think, let me just address the car thing first, because I think, although that wasn't the point of your question, I think it actually draws out some other observations. I actually do think our cars and driving is much safer today than it was 30 years ago, for example. And a lot of that was driven by both liability and insurance. So in other words, the reason, you know, there are automatic seat belts and all this stuff is because of the legal incentives that were in place that made it both necessary for manufacturers to build those in, and prudent for all of us to try to use those measures, using a seatbelt as an example, for our own insurance. It doesn't make it perfect, of course. I mean, and one would hope it would be safer. I think actually the car industry elucidates how incentives can manage risk, if not eliminate it. But your point is well taken, because I think that was an easy problem compared to cyber. I mean, car accidents are trying to account for the risk of largely unintentional accidents, mishaps. With cyber, we're really talking about intentional conduct. So unlike, it's not like you have drivers on the street who are actively trying to hit you, and insurance is trying to deal with that risk. That's, yeah, sometimes. But really, cyber is about, it's not about all of us moving around out there in cyberspace and occasionally bumping into each other and bad things happening. It's about really bad people trying to do those really bad things. And so it's actually far more even complex than the situation of cars. Personally, my philosophy is grand theories of building things right from the beginning just won't work. That's just my predilection. It kind of depends on political philosophy of who one is. For me, I would say small practical steps are probably the right way to go, as unsatisfactory as they might be from either an intellectual standpoint or a completion standpoint. And for better or worse, that's definitely the approach this administration has taken of how to address the cyber problem. I think it's unsatisfying for a lot who have been in this space, because things don't seem to be getting better, and people seem to be spending a lot of money that is often inefficient. I think that's a fair point. You know, like everything, I think it's going to get better. It's just a question of how painful it'll be to get there.
So I think we're going to have to call it to a close now. We have a reception at DuPont Hall, so if there are other questions, we've gone about 10 minutes over, but I wanted to have plenty of time for exchange with Raj. So please join me in welcoming him for a really great presentation and a distinguished address. So let's thank Raj again.